Welcome back, everybody, here to your coverage of the MSI Beta Qualifiers. I'm Toby One.
And I'm the Capitalist.
And we have returned to you from the Twitter studio here in Berlin, casting the Middle Eastern Qualifier for the MSI Beta 2014. And, well, we have ourselves a team which we weren't expecting to see here, but we're going to follow them nonetheless. They're a Terra Firma. Is their name right now. The new squad coming out from Bucking Mad, who a lot of people will know from the TI analyst desk, as well as the ESL1 analyst desk, as well as every other analyst desk, which I think we can possibly put him onto. But yes, that's the squad. They convincingly moved through game number one, and now they're up against Mideast, who did win their first round matchup up against... well, they got a bye through their very first round matchup, and then they got a win up against Okandos.
Arkandos. 5 seconds remaining.
Is who they
Good.
Beat.
I'm glad to see. I thought you were gonna say a bye. I was just like, wait, how did they get a bye and Terra Firma did not?
No. They had a 1-0 win, and Terra Firma had a bye as well through their first round. So had a bullet. Basically, there was I believe about 70 teams or so that actually checked in after they signed
you're
up.
Right on the cusp.
Yes. So we had a bracket of 128, which people just bumped through. So we're now actually into the round of 32. In fact, most teams are already getting themselves into this round. This game obviously deciding a little bit earlier than before. But the winner of this game will play up against the winner of Ionix as well as Riot, who are also playing their game already. So we'll have our 8th match today. I don't know if we're actually going to finish today. But it's potential. Like, the possibility is there. Either way, if we don't finish today, you can come back tomorrow. There's more interaction tomorrow.
Yay!
In multiple locations as well.
Indeed.
Yeah, for people who don't know, Cap will be here doing our wonderful coverage of iLeague, which shout out to you guys who were here for that one, as well as doing the MSI Beta Day 2 of the qualifier. We'll be getting at 16 EST tomorrow.
So we will get the finals of Terra Firma versus some Middle East.
Somebody
team.
Else.
presumably.
If you're going to bet rares, that's the way you would assume it. And I will be down in Cologne. I'll be traveling to Cologne. I will not be going to Gamescom. I was actually given the option if I wanted to have a walk around Gamescom for one of the days. Mm-hmm. And I'm just like, sorry, I need to get back to Capitalist. I need to get back to
We get lonely when Toby's gone.
We got so much stuff to do at Join Dota that like even taking one day off just to walk around Gamescom, I don't feel right about it. I really don't. So yeah, I'll be coming straight back again. But if you want to see me and you're going to be in Cologne, come and have a visit down at the ESL Studios. I'll be doing the Red Bull Battlegrounds event. So yeah, that'll be also coming out, but joindota.com for all the live stream links and everything else. I'll be there with MYM and Coast. But yes, this game though is already very much underway as far as the draft goes. And Terra Firma looks like Mads drafting a classic, and I'm not seeing the Mirana being banned out just yet. I'm feeling Bane, Mirana as cores in this lineup. Paris plays a lot of Mirana. Tidehunter as well, easier offlane, easy anywhere you really want to throw him. But you get Enchantress instead. Okay, well, this doesn't limit the lineup, but it just gives Mad a jungler.
Right, and you mean Bane as a support here?
Yeah, so yeah, say carry. Yeah. I say carry.
Yeah, you said Bane and Mirana as cores, and I was like, what?
Sorry, I didn't mean to say core. I meant combo.
Let's see a core Bane, man. That guy is the ultimate 1v1 hero.
That would never work.
He's the ultimate 1v1 hero, though.
I don't... Well, yeah.
He's the ultimate 1v1 hero.
But you don't need to give him farm. You need to
give
him levels. Like, you need to give him levels. Like, maybe
exactly. Solo 1v1.
Okay, maybe you could run him as a mid-solo for the first part of the game, but the second you were ready for him to go one-on-one soloing and killing off people, you would rotate someone else into the mid lane to take up the farm.
He goes Enfeeble, he goes Life Sap, he picks up an early set of Phase Boots, and he goes ham from there. If he was a maxed out ranged hero, I bet there would be teams experimenting with that. The problem is he has no range whatsoever. So, on the other side, we have Mideast, who have picked themselves up both a Shadow Shaman as well as the Wraith King in the first 1-2, then grabbed themselves the Tinker. The Tinker is going to be interesting here. So, Terra Firma are probably going to be going for a very aggressive lineup, is what I would say. I never want to go up against a Tinker going into the late game. So I would assume that the Enchantress is going to be pushing down a lot of towers. They're going to use the Tidehunter as either an initiator or a sustain hero. Because Tidehunter mech is not beyond the realm of possibility. It's actually pretty good for a Tidehunter. So Either way, he either gets the initiation onto the Tinker, or he gives them enough sustain to be able to take down towers despite March of the Machines being spammed out. Now a Lich being picked up, which now locks us into a Wraith King as a core position.
Why the Lich, though? Radiant my huge problem with Mideast's lineup right now is the fact that their backs are going to be completely broken. Because you got an Enchantress pushing in with a Bane, with a Tide, with a Mirana. You get a lot of initiation as well as abilities to bring down the towers. Mm-hmm. If this is actually a solo mid Mirana and we end up bringing something like a Luna into the lineup of Terra, they could completely mow over Mideast all out of towers. Tinker will never have space to farm up into his BTs. And any stacks will be forfeit after that point because he won't be able to get out there to farm them. Not with the mana it actually can like have.
Yeah.
So the Lich for me may make this lane too passive. And Enchantress is the perfect hero for attacking in like the first 1 to 2 minutes because you have two creeps that can just force down towers. Maybe even three if you're fast enough.
Yeah, there are many supports that do not contribute very much to defending towers. Lich actually has a negative impact in that regard because he's actually killing your creeps that are supposed to be defending your towers. So there's some... Yeah, I don't agree with the Lich either. Maybe they're just trying to make some really strong dual lanes and go from there and just win by the laning phase. But as you said, Enchantress is going to come in within the first 5 minutes and probably push down at least one tower. Viper is going to be grabbed by Mideast, though. That gives them a very, very good mid-game-oriented hero, but Terra Firma are going to lock in the Kunkka almost immediately in response to that, which gives them a good amount of tank, a good catch-out hero for the Tinker, some additional lockdown against him, and in general, just strong team fight. So it's just all push around the Enchantress with very, very strong early team fight that Mideast can't deal with. Not Lich. Prepare. I mean, those first couple of pushes are probably going to be before the Lich hits level 6. Tinker does nothing against early pushes. Viper is a single target hero, so he can't actually do much to stop pushes. Like, he can fight for sure and he can kill heroes, but he cannot stop the actual pushes themselves. And, Shadow Shaman is another actually really weak support hero early on into the game. Unless he somehow gets a lot of levels in the laning phase and is able to get a maxed out Aether Shock fairly early on, he's fairly weak versus pushes as well.
I want to ask you the question, Cap.
Yes.
I am really bad at flags. But can you...
No.
Can anybody... No. Challenge to the chat right now. No, can you name... all four flags, which they're currently displaying here. Because I cannot.
I can't. I don't want to embarrass myself like that.
Neither do I. Yeah. I have no idea what any of these flags are, actually. Especially when we're paused, so it's grayed out, so you don't even get like the real colors anymore.
Yeah.
Like, one of them made me think of the South African flag, but I'm like, wait, that's not right. No.
I believe one of them was Saudi Arabia, and the another one was Iran, but I'm probably wrong. Probably wrong.
Yeah.
Terra Firma, their lanes should be fairly simple. Okay, maybe not.
Yeah, they've actually sent the Mirana down to the bottom lane, but this is mad strategies. Like, this is the way he likes to run the lineups. They did this a hell of a lot. Like, a hell of a lot back when he was as, actually, do we say when he was MTW? Like, because MTW did this a lot, but he also did it with other teams. He likes doing the Bane Mirana offlane duo.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it's a lane which you know you can't get killed on, because you got both Nightmare as well as Leap to escape you out. But you know you have potential for killing as well. Mm-hmm. So it's not just a passive lane, it's a lane where you force supports to come over and respond to you, which makes space in the other lanes. Now, Mucking Mag can already tip the scales up on the top lane. You got Mango as the Tidehunter up here. He's going to have himself a rough time up against the Viper, especially considering we got no Stout Shield over on this Tidehunter. He brought a lot of consumables instead. But yeah. Mad just needs himself a good creep, a Harpy or something like that, and he can actually zone out the top lane too.
Yeah, it's not going to take too much for him to. I'm sorry, I was like, why in the world is Nahaz putting Dire Tide in our stats at all? But I get it. It's a play on words. Well done, Nahaz. Well done. Tidehunter on the dire side.
Oh, the D warning. He's missing a pill.
You know why?
Nice denied. Yeah, she denied the war too. So no bonus 50 gold for you. The man might have to drop a secondary observer ward here.
I didn't actually read the stat, but I'm pretty sure that Nahaz's stat was probably based around Roshan. He and I both really like those Roshan stats on dire side. And Tidehunter is a minus armor hero.
It looks like the chat did come through. There's a lot of people saying it was Saudi Arabia, Iran, Kuwait, Iraq, and Lebanon.
Kuwait
was one of the ones that came through.
There was one of the flags I recognized, but I couldn't possibly think of the name of the country.
I assume it's the nationalities of the guys from the team.
I would assume so as well.
Yeah, that's where I go with it. It's nice to see. It's a world game, man. Like, a lot of people, like, I know when we got in here, we're just like, hey, Terraformers playing. We'll have some entertaining games today. But at the same time, you have to understand, like, all the scenes, like, they've got to build up from somewhere. And that's one thing I really like about the MSI Beat It. It gives a chance for teams to really just, like, battle it out and qualify for big tournaments no matter where you are from around the world. Now, there's trouble here on this bottom lane. We've got the Wraith King on the run, but it's Nightmare. Into arrow. Back yourself up there, Geralt. There you go. Into the arrow. More time to attack. You might even want to actually walk a little bit more forward than just basically attacking, but they'll have enough damage nonetheless to get the kill. And this is what I'm talking about. You can't leave just one hero to battle up against a Morana Bane combo. It forces supports to rotate down and be there on the lane. Unfortunately, heroes like a Shadow Shaman are not the heroes you want to have against this lane because he's just as much food as the next man.
Yeah, it really is. I mean, he gets caught out by his sleep arrow, and he will have no impact in the skirmish at all. He will die before he gets off any abilities. So, unfortunately,
it's Kuwait, Saudi, and Omnan and Jordan. Wait, what?
What?
Sorry, the flags. I almost want to correct it, but I don't know what's correct.
Yeah.
Yeah, my bad. Nightmare, bottom lane. And here we go again. Arrow, the Nightmare, not being taken off, but this is the point I'm talking about. Shadow Shaman had a half-life. He'll have to burn through. He doesn't want to burn through his Sal, but if he uses his Tango right now, I guess not enough life points that if he gets initiated on again, he's going to die. They just need to get the timing right. At least the Tinker's having himself a good time by pushing out this middle lane, but it's also March to the Machines. So by throwing that down this lane very early on, that's what we saw like with Excalibur playing his Tinker earlier today. He went for laser and just held off for the next points. Okay, Nightmare. Arrow, take the Nightmare off him. And he still got hit by the arrow. Hellfire Blast to Babar. There's not enough mana up his sleeve to go for a Brain Sap, but the Mirana's already got one kill. Man stopped moving for a moment so we can micro up the Centaur. He's already gone for the Stomp. So it's one hero down, and they can dive under here. No, they can't, actually. The Babar's too low on life. He's going to be a little bit more passive about this. And hey! With shackles on the centaur, they've taken away one very
big get that stun centaur. Just there. Get it.
If Mad wants to, he could actually go in after the Wraith King. Look at even the creep weight. Like, the tree line's been like completely separated here. So there's multiple points of access for TF.
I mean, I suppose technically the Shadow Shaman didn't use as much mana because he still had some fountain regen.
Yeah.
And technically the Wraith King was probably going to go back anyway. But that was just an odd.
Yeah, it was an unusual shackle, yeah. And now they actually spot out the Shadow Shaman. But Geralt wants nothing to do with it
as well. So that ward's going to be countered.
They're
probably
coming
fairly
mid lane.
Early on.
They're coming middle lane. Like, you see the liner being drawn up, but that's actually from Wraith King. But the smoke movement will come out, and well, there's no observer was looking for this, but you see Tinker hugging the tree line, but with the Hellbear, they can just walk in behind the tower. Now, the Hellbear smoke breaks. The Enchant will have to go to try and slow him down. They could just go for a Nightmare, but they kind of want to make sure the Tinker can't get out of this one. So he's in the tree line. The Hellbear goes down, dying to the march. And Babba's like, I want to cut my way through here. Okay, found him. Kunkka, Torrent, straight follow-up. They got to turn the Nightmare off. Up he goes up and towards the air. They drag the creep wave off. Okay, this is becoming a mess.
I'm not sure.
Where was the combo? It wasn't there.
Yeah, I don't know. Mad, I think, was supposed to be there at some point in time, but he's still just a right-click hero. Like, his creep dies, he's not really that threatening. Yeah. So
he has enchant, so you'll get a slowdown from that, but that's basically all. Now, there's a Hex from Shadow Shaman, but again, he's got to stop using these disables before he really needs to, because it means when the support comes in, you got an enchant going off now, which means Geralt hitting this arrow is pretty high. He doesn't need to. 2-point start.
You miring those arrows, brah? You miring them?
Dude, I hit my head too hard. Admiral, he's going to get body blocked up here by Soshka. And one more attack from Dadlar, but they give it to Kunkka. So he'll take the kill. He's also got an Invis rune, so he can easily rotate out and manage to searching for a new creep. He can take an Alpha Wolf, but it won't really help him that much. How's his top lane going? We haven't even talked about Tide versus Viper.
I was just about to try and direct your attention to that top lane because it looks like Tidehunter is actually winning.
God, that facepalm actually causes pain.
So Tidehunter has picked up Arcane Boots before he's picked up his ultimate, which I would say is really good timing for him. He shouldn't be even on this lane.
What are you doing, Matt? What are you doing with this? Sorry, go back to it. Viper is about to kill off the Tidehunter. He's lit up the Viper Strike. No Anchor Smash. Takes away all the damage.
Or is he?
There's TP support coming in. And Bane, if he runs down, he's going to run straight down right now. There's no TP scroll for Viper. There's a Nightmare, Anchor Smash, and then just Brain Sap and kill secured. But they want to give it to Mango. Oh, wow. They may have just thrown away their kill
Bar-bar.
Here. Look at his movement speed. Wait, he backed up.
What did you do?
I don't know.
Babar.
Well, Babar is a kid's character, man. Like, he's meant to...
Come on,
he's
now.
Meant to give everyone an equal chance.
I don't... Why didn't he just brain zap?
I don't... What did he brain
zap? Don't do that, kid.
Just kill secure. We got some troubles for Tinker. He's currently being attacked while he's looking to do an ancient stack area.
And being chased into the Bane.
I'd be very careful about this courier who is currently bringing in a bottle. Mad will see this and then decide which one does he want. Okay, he's going to try and take out the Fleet Admiral, and he's going to be... Not actually successful. There she is. The Shadow Blast was still there, so there's more than enough damage. Back in middle lane, Shadow Shaman actually able to hold Kunkka in position. One more attack from Kunkka will get the kill, but he'll lose his life underneath the tower. Courier. Okay, it seems like everyone's just happy to let couriers live today, even though they're going into the most dangerous zones of the world. And Mad will have to walk past the Viper and then steal his haste ring. Is he going to go for any kind of attack here? No, he shouldn't.
You could say that mid lane is a no-fly zone.
Oh! That's bad.
That was pretty bad.
Oh wow, he can't stack anymore.
Nope. It's the
glitch.
It's the Thunderhide.
This guy is such. He's a douche.
Yep. Really
Morana gets a solo kill on the Wraith King as well, but in middle lane they've torrented up Tinker. There's your quick brain sap. But the Martian Machines, Soshka as well as Babar may even die here. Soshka trying to use the catapult as a bit of cover, but yep, okay. They both get out to safety. That much, they were not ready for a level 3 march to do that much damage.
So the death on Viper delayed his mech, which is seriously harming Mideast, because they're already in some trouble.
Yep.
The Tidehunter is doing well in his lane, which means he's going to be able to pick up a fast Blink Dagger, despite the fact that I would say Viper should still handedly crush a Tidehunter.
Top lane.
He's done fine.
They're coming in for the Viper. Hey! Ravage. Sentinel Hoofstomp directly after it, and then they're just going to keep battling him out. With the Viper Strike, he'll slow down Mango, but there's enough there's enough damage, man. When they got the Swiftosaur at 2, so they are attacking fast enough, and the Enchantress range damage is enough.
They would not have killed him if Tidehunter didn't hit level 7 there.
True.
He hit level 7 and then leveled Gush and immediately hit the Viper.
Oh, at least Ravage hits creep waves then. Well, right now, man, I'm still looking at the highest net worth on the map being the Morana. The offlane Morana is the highest net worth.
Well, you flagged it pretty early. I mean, there's nothing Mideast can do against this dual lane. Too much kill for them.
They're going to go again too. This Wraith King's not level 6 yet, so he's got no protection. He's going underneath the tower. Even the basic attack damage coming up from Rana is high. And hey! Lich ulti. Babar's going to go down. The arrow will connect, but in comes Soshka. Babar's
gone!
He actually used one charges. He's going to survive through this one. Turn around. Nightmare up, so Zoa can't even kill him off. Frostblast for Babar. He's on 6 life points. 12 seconds until TP, but the creep wave's on top of the tier 1 tower. So he could just walk himself out. One
Babar,
life point. He's on one life point because of the ship as well.
Yes,
because the damage
ship.
Never came in.
Babar, how do you sleep yourself and still get away? What the hell?
Denied. Bottom tower. Wraith King. Denied. At least that's one upside for him. But the downside is X marks the spot's going to drag him back.
What? You miring those torrents, baby? You miring them?
admiring that leap from Jarl. That was really nice. Was now nice. In comes the help from the Shadow Shaman. Vasoshka is going for the Tauren again.
Oh, God.
And they've already got the kill. The drum charge being triggered. They're moving fast. They're moving hard.
Mistakes were made.
Yes, they
Mistakes
were.
Mistakes were made. Wraith King comes back and immediately gets hit by the Tidebringer splash.
Oh.
Just falters.
Mad's about to gank up on top lane. Yep. The Viper's up a long way up here. This time they won't have the Ravage, however, so it won't be as easy. And they've only got the Thunder Clamp, so it's a secondary slow, but they've got Impetus damage from Mad. And that's enough. One more, Mad. Boom! And the range. Oh, it's not enough. Ooh. 44 life points he'll survive on. Shadow Shaman TP's up as well as Lich. So they still force a two support rotation.
Hey, so I want to talk about this. This is something I've never really thought about as a good counter to the Viper, but if you notice, there's actually a large amount of pure damage from Terra Firma. The early Brain Sap nuke, 300 damage, pure damage nuke, so they don't have to worry about that magic defense.
Baba, I don't think he'll survive through this one, but then again, Chip, Torrent, Kanka, he's still got Brain Sap, and he's got, well, he did the Chain Sap over on the Lich, which I think is the one he wanted. Lich is on 22 life points, and Soshka is on a mission from Kanka. He is going to try and chase down the Lich, and X, Torrent, this time the combo will be right. Meanwhile,
cool
back in the middle lane,
explosions.
It looks like Kanka.
Nope.
Tidehunter walks into the Tinker's March of the Machines. Oh, Tinker was knighting that up. The Starfall, well out of range. One more attack. Okay, they actually don't do the attack. Lasoshka was waiting for the last attack so he can get himself a triple kill. So sacrifice Babar.
So the Admiral kills the Fleet Admiral.
Ironic.
Kanka has just received a promotion, apparently.
Either that or the I smell mutiny. I smell mutiny, damn it.
He's going to have himself a pretty early Shadow Blade here. So even more physical burst damage. So yeah, there's a lot of physical damage spells. For example, Tidehunter's Anchor Smash, which is physical damage, so you don't have to worry about the Viper, his Corrosive Skin, magic resistance from that. Even if Viper is hard to hit with an Anchor Smash, if you do hit him, you don't have to worry about the magic resistance. Same goes with the Impetus as well as the Bane. There's two different sources of
courier.
Pure damage.
Courier. Jarl actually using Arrow to give vision on the Courier. Now, the Radiant Courier was walking around with the Buckler recipe, but that was off. And Soshka is now taking the Tinker stack. This is what I'm talking about before during the drafting time. With a Lich, it's too passive. You can't push back out again. And any stacks which you do attempt to have, you lose. Because you lose your map control. Ow.
You need to stop hurting yourself.
Yeah, I know. Okay, Viper ulti, Mad. Well, he's got 4 points untouchable, so even when they do attack him,
they don't move. They don't move.
Wind her up. Big swing, but no ding ding. In they come. The turret over on top of the Viper. There's no mana for a ship, but there's mana for a 5-man Ravage in from Mango. He splits the fruit, and now there's Fiend's Grip over on the Wraith King. A little bit more difficult fighting inside the March of the Machines. Soshka, stop killing yourself. But they will survive, and they get 4 heroes down for this one. The Tinker TPing himself back to base, and then back up to top. Dire's middle tower
is under attack. Credit to the Tinker. I think he's doing pretty well, considering the massive advantage the Terra Firma have. He's done a good job. Like when he dodged that First Blood gank. Or not First Blood, but that gank in middle lane or very early on. Where the Bane went for the dive. I think the little things like that, I think Tinker's actually had some pretty good awareness of his positioning. Unfortunately, he's fallen so far behind that he's not going to have his Blink Dagger very soon, but even once he does have the Blink Dagger, that's where this X marks the spot is going to come into play. The long range, in fact, I would almost say that Kunkka should be maxing out X marks the spot just so you could have the 950 range available to you. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't matter whether or not Tinker has a Blink if you hit the X.
The D warding finally coming out from Shadow Shaman, but knowing that now he's going to actually trigger the Thunderhide and just block it. It looks like Mad's getting ready to go in for Roshan. While top tier 1 tower is still not down just yet, so they might bring the Tidehunter over. While we actually have a little bit of a lull inside the game, if you haven't done so yet, go over to joindota.com and you'll see that ESL 1 New York 2014 has now been announced. So, we'll be there casting that one, having ourselves a great old time. So definitely tune in. It's going to be great. Madison Square Theater is where it will be held. So great times around there. And of course, don't forget as well, we'll also, well, Capitalist will actually be attending the Taiwan Grand Finals for the Fnatic MSI Beat It. So if you want to go meet Capitalist and you live in Southeast Asia or can make the trip over to Taiwan, go and see Cap. He's going to be over there, and I believe he'll actually be there with Zoe and maybe a couple of other people too. Amazing LAN events coming up for the remaining part of this year. I was actually doing the calculation so far. We've been asked to do 7 different LAN events.
Really?
Yeah, already, and there's still more to be potentially confirmed just for the end of this year. Okay, Alex Key is going to go down right now, or is it going to be... Okay, we got Kanker. Who's going to die first? It's going to be Wraith King, but don't worry, he'll reincarnate, so we'll jump back up to the top where the ship has managed to hit the Viper. Ancient of Shaman's already gone down here, and now Lich Ultimate. He didn't throw it over on the Bane, however, which means there was no stun to stop the Fiend script. Guaranteed kill over on the Viper, and now X, just okay, not even going to work. The Brain Sap's already done its work. And
the Rocket
Admiral is the only one. The Rocket, not enough to kill off Paris.
It didn't hit Paris.
It didn't?
It hit the Bane. I think he lost vision.
Oh, that's not nice for him. They need everything they can get right now, man. They have a 14,000 gold deficit.
I know.
15,000 experience deficit. Things are not going well.
Increase the number of kills you have by 33%. Would have been huge. Chrysalis is about to be picked up by the Kunkka.
We get a 15-minute maelstrom with drums as well as Ring of Aquila over on the Mirana.
Tough news.
Yeah. That's a lot of damage coming out from a Mirana this early on, and now we're getting a 4-star being built over on top of the Bane.
And Mad's going to have an Aghanim's another 1,000
gold. Wow.
Yep.
We're at that point again, just like the Ancient Apparition from earlier today. Aghanim's for 4-second level ultimate. That's the potential of what we're looking at right now. March the Machine's keeping top lane at bay. So this is a bit of a downside though for Terraformer, which is very different to their lineup, which they were running in their last game, is they can't just breach high ground straight away. Because if they try and breach high ground straight away, they're gonna find themselves taking a lot of damage and potentially giving away a lot of free gold and experience over to ME.
Oh yeah,
they're gonna be a little bit more passive about this and need the higher damage output over on the Kunkka, even though for 17 minutes in with a Crystallis as well as a Shadow Blade, obviously his damage output is bloody good. But they also need the physical continuous damage coming out from the Mirana and initiation from the Tidehunter. And they've actually got the initiation from Tidehunter. He's already got it.
Maybe they can go uphill.
Really? Why?
Because I'm looking at this. Viper doesn't have a mech yet.
Huh.
It's 17 minutes in for a Viper who is 1v1 up against a Tidehunter.
I still say Martian Machines would be enough to hold him back.
Yeah, I think it's unwise. I would agree. I think it's unwise for them to try and go uphill. But Viper, between the Martian Machines mixed in with Viper and Wraith King both being pretty strong mid-game heroes. Even
come on, dude, man. Like, X marks the spot yourself in for a run. That's what you can do as a Kunkka. Okay. He's not doing it.
He's lying in wait.
He could actually crit on the creep wave and almost kill the Viper in one go. Okay, he didn't do it. Ship, Torrent, he's waiting out for the swing. There goes your swing. Hoof Stomp was perfect from Matt as well. But now Soshka's gonna give away his Aegis Immortal, but they baited out the Lich ultimate. So Soshka can die right now. And Matt just gotta make sure he gets out to safety. Extra TP support's gonna be coming in right now from the Tinker, and they're gonna actually look to kill off Matt. The dust was triggered, and that's when he came back, and Soshka, okay. That's a large amount of crit leap. Whoa!
Oh, no!
No, 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 no! The arrow's gonna completely miss. Hellfire Blast. Okay, now Mango's turn. Blink, he doesn't have mana for a Ravage.
Oh, God.
He's short.
Anchor smash him. Where are you going, Tide?
Oh. He's going back to the creep wave, but then they're going to just focus to bring down the tier 2 tower. Now they lost a couple of heroes. They did some nice damage.
You got to man up. You got to man up when you have maxed out Kraken Shell.
That's fortification TP coming in from the Tinker, and very wisely cancelled from the Tinker. Because the arrow from Jiral would hit perfectly. And Bane with Fiend's Grip as well. If the arrow didn't connect, the Bane would have controlled him.
It's just like it's very wise not to step into oncoming traffic.
Hey, you ever played Frogger? Sometimes you gotta take a risk.
Viper.
Somebody
gold.
Make that custom map. Somebody make Frogger for Fedota. It will be featured on Custom Dota when you send it to custom at joindota.com. We will feature it on our Custom Dota series. It'll be fantastic.
You're going to start a trend of bad retro games.
No, you do Frogger. Like,
not that Frogger is bad,
it's like Uther Party.
Uh-huh.
Okay, Lich is in a lot of trouble. Like, a lot of trouble. Matt is standing right next to him with an Invis rune.
And level 2 in Pettis.
And now, like, if he does the D ward here, okay, they forced up. Semi-body block. No, don't Fiend's Grip this one. You don't need to Fiend's Grip this one. Impetus damage okay, he's in trouble. You got a Brain Zap. Bad bar. Brain Zap. Brain Zap. He couldn't make a decision. He tried to Nightmare. He wasn't sure if he was going to Brain Zap. He wasn't quite sure if he was going to Fiend's Grip.
He's like, do I Brain Zap? Do I Nightmare myself? Do I Nightmare one of them? Do I feed myself to Ancients? I don't know what to do.
You know what you call that? A Nightmare of a decision.
Radiant's top tower has
Moonlight Shadow. Soshka looking for the crit. The Ravage. Way! Are you going to go for the Shadow Shaman? The Torrent, the ship, everything's flying in right now, but everything's going to miss because they've already got the kill. Well, they move over to the Wraith King and Pettis damage. They need a stun. They just, okay, they trigger the Reincarnation, but this means that he also has no TP out of here. And Pettis damage 1, and Pettis damage 2, and the Urn Charge will actually... is it enough damage? You use Stick Charges. Okay, Blink to Anchor Smash will take the kill. But they lost the Kunkka for this one. Literally, no!
Oh, no!
Split it! Matt, no! Wait, what?
They didn't kill him.
Yeah, he's on
left with 14 health.
But I'm surprised it didn't bounce to Jural.
I'm surprised too.
it was here to here. Oh yeah, that's not much of a leap for a Lich ultimate to do.
Haste.
I think they should be really cut there, MV. That Lich ultimate should have bounced.
Middies, they need every kill they can get too.
Ice Frog is just like getting in there and saying, I need to give some extra support to Middle East. Lich bounce range. Taken away. Damn it, I went to put positive, not negative. Minus is positive, positive is negative. Ah!
Agonyms.
Yes, 21 minutes in.
Huzzah.
And now you can. Again, actually, look at Matt, he's done this again. He's going for this casual belt of strength. Maybe it's just the way he plays his jungle heroes.
No, okay, this makes sense because you should be getting a treads.
Yes.
On your Enchantress.
Yes.
The Enigma was a little more iffier, but.
But maybe it's just a thing. It's like what he's trying to make his new thing. Like, he's the casual belt man.
Yeah, he displays he has 100% win rate with Belt of Strength.
Well, he does have a lot of style as a Frenchman. So maybe he's just like, well, I always bring a belt to a Dota 2 game.
Who are the only players with 20 or more pro Dota 2 wins as Tinker?
Excalibur.
Sure.
I almost want to say
there is no other...
I want to say
player.
Eternal Envy or Sing Sing would be trick potentially question in that list. Because I know they had a lot of success with their Tinker. But there was also, like, Arteezy played a lot of Tinker too. As far as China goes, like, who else, like, down in Southeast Asia, China would have played around with
it? I can't believe, there are only two players with 20 wins. 20 wins is a lot. Why can't we think of the other? Is it Arteezy?
Arteezy because I don't think Arteezy's played enough Tinker to make 20 wins.
Yeah, I don't think so either. Why the hell? It's Koifa!
Koifa, yeah, Koifa!
Jesus, right. That should just be so easy.
It's funny because my brain was going to, like, does anyone, like, maybe Ferrari plays it. Maybe someone else plays it.
My head couldn't think of Western play.
It's like VG Gaming. Do they play Tinker enough?
I think there's anybody in China that has more than 10 wins on Tinker.
Because Jessica can play enough. Bulba.
I was going to say Bulba potentially.
Arteezy is 8-3, so we were pretty damn close on him. There's a lot of. Oh, hey! Oh, no, Tinker! Oh, Tinker! He blinked into the Mirana, who was hiding in the tree line waiting for an arrow moment. And he blinked into the direct position the Mirana was sitting. It's when you realize that mistakes were, they weren't made on purpose. We have a double also Army of the Dead. Mad's going to lose one of his Dark Troll Warlord Summoners, but this is going to be pushes on towers from multiple
Radiant
angles.
Tower
at least Middle East was able to pull the creep wave off the top tier 2, so they'll only lose one tier 2 tower at this point. But it's just going to be a simple rotation top.
BKB Radiant's soon for the Kunkka.
Someone said DDZ. Actually, where was DDZ on that list?
Apparently DDZ and Excalibur, and apparently Arteezy have not played enough to get 20 wins.
Interesting. I suppose DDZ, DDZ started playing a lot of Tinker, and when he started, like, there's like maybe 5, maybe 10 games where he just don't. Hey! Oh, wow, that's smart by Mango. Gushed him, four-staffed him up the hill, and then killed him off. But DDZ had a lot of Tinker banned against him, because it was just Tinker and Invoker was banned against him. He played a lot of Invoker.
Yeah, Invoker especially.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, Jarl's back to farming up in bottom lane. He's actually finished a full manta and still has another 1,000 gold to spare. But currently the courier is busy flying out of BKB to Soshka. So Terraform is looking good right now.
It's funny because I was going to be like, Bulba, I was going to say Bulba must be on the list, but he must not have made 20 wins yet. But it's just because it's been so long ago since we saw Bulba Tinker being run consistently, just because Coifa has been doing it for all this time. That you kind of forget how much Bulba was playing Tinker back in the day.
Yeah. We forget. It's a history just.
Too much Dota history. Too many Dota games.
Really, a lot of Dota history gets forgotten, man.
How many Roshans do you think have you seen die?
So yeah, DDT is 10 for 3.
10 for 3. Nature attend us. Like, Excalibur is 4 and 5. Excalibur has a losing record on Tinker.
Oh, that's just painful.
Wow.
Well, the Excalibur did have, like, for all his domination, Excalibur did find himself where he was the only man in Fnatic who had a lot of farm. And then if he gets picked off in the later portion of the game, he loses. And that did happen a lot, because Excalibur is a very over-aggressive player. Sometimes just throttling it is a little bit more difficult for him. Soshka free farming top. He can almost finish his Daedalus soon. Like, he can at least pick up the Demon Edge.
Refresher is going to be farmed up on the Tidehunter before they go in. Full-out Manta is up for the Morana. They could wait for Mjolnir, I suppose. Meanwhile, Daedalus required for Paris. I think once those items are up, they'll probably try and push uphill.
Yeah, this is Terraformer waiting for the right time to push in. And when that time is right, they just go. They'll keep the pressure on the lanes in the meantime. But a little bit more space. If they get a pick off, that's great. Okay, well, they brought four heroes to bottom lane. That's not the whole thing. Like, they need Conqueror as well to make sure they win a team fight. And now Mad, maybe a little bit of trouble, but he gets four-staffed up, and now they can go for like a four-man Ravage, actually four-staffing in to try and make sure they got it. The Viper's already on the sidelines. Blade Mount, Mad, he's actually killing himself on this one, but he doesn't seem to care, while the Lich Ultimate is still bouncing around. The Mass Wards are holding him here, so it's actually a double kill coming in for Jarl. They lost the Tidehunter in this one, and now X marks spot. Tinker wanted out of this one. He looks to blink himself away. Soshka with the DD rune, they're gonna come in closer. There's a Nightmare, they're waiting it out. Enchantress, there's your arrow, looking for the swing, and that's gonna be the Wraith King down. Jarl with a triple kill as that Morana leaps up to safety so they can try and heal up, but the March Machines will stop this creep for this push.
There goes the beginning of the Dagon, unfortunately, with the BKB already preemptively up for the Kunkka. He shouldn't have any issues with a lot of this burst magic damage.
Come on, Sprites. Yeah, he's fine, man. Yeah. Even if they do, like you start the initial attacks, maybe a good Nightmare will actually stop it. Like, the Dagon at level 1 isn't enough to get an instant kill. They're looking towards Bane in the middle lane, but like, even when he brain saps like that, okay, they're better trying to be special and Nightmare away from the rockets. Radiant's bottom tower was under attack. Yeah.
How much longer on the Aegis? Because they just finished up the Daedalus. They could probably... They still have enough time to be able to go uphill, and Refresher is going to be up soon. Like 300 gold.
Nice.
So double Ravage, Daedalus crit, everything's dead. Everything's dead.
Basically, yes. That's the way that Terraformer sees
it going.
Don't
look
down
at the other heroes. Just they're single target. Who cares about them? Look at the AoE guys. Just double Ravage, Daedalus crit. Game has been won. We'll see whether or not the RNG's gods grant them.
Well, so far I haven't seen it happen here for Soshka. He hasn't got the the big hits. Top lane movement, Tinker just blinking
arrow
himself away. Is that arrow going to be on target? No.
Good guess, though.
He'll leap him. Gets an arrow. An arrow hit from his basic attack. But we've got next mark spot onto the Wraith King in the middle lane. And unfortunately for Wraith King, he has no reincarnation. So, and this Blade Mail isn't protecting him anywhere near as much as he probably thought it would. And now they can just turn around. Mass Serpent Wars might be on the deck. But there's your crit. He doesn't want to walk into the full march of the machines. But one more swipe into the Lich, and he gets himself a double kill. And the Viper will go down to the Enchantress. Now, Matt doesn't even care about the Blade Mail. He's walking around with an Ultimate Orb and an Aghanim Scepter. The stats on this Enchantress allow him to tank up almost anything.
Well, let's see how well Fleet Admiral can turtle this out.
Problem is, his regeneration's taking too long.
All it's gonna take is one blind jump in Ravage from Mango.
Yeah.
And if he catches the Tinker.
His refresh has arrived, so he will have no problem with doing a blind Ravage. Because he knows he'll have another one. Actually, will he?
Yeah, if you use your mana boots correctly.
As opposed to if you hold on to those stick charges he's got.
Yeah, you Ravage, you mana boots, you refresher, you mana boots again, then Ravage. You should, yeah. If you have 900 mana, you easily can do it. Especially since he's not level 16. He gets a little bit more difficult once you buff up the Ravage a bit more. Because it costs an extra 100 mana as well. Which is an extra 200 mana when you're using Refresher.
Sashka's burnt out a lot of time with this Aegis.
Illusion.
Like, it's going to expire within the next minute or so. So they're going to try and like use Sashka as bait for a couple of abilities. It's top lane where the gank is going to come, though. And Geralt, leap. Mana style, leap. And this is the problem. They can't control it. Smoke's been used. The Wraith King's out a long way, but they know now Terraformer, they can just split push. And there it is. 1 minute on the clock. So the second we hit 31:29, the Aegis is gone.
So time to go full out yellow. Just charge in, start feeding on the tower.
Now Sashka gets a crit. he's looking up X, Torrent. There's no follow-up Torrent. He's going to let the Shadow Shaman just be X'd back. I think Geralt's still trying to keep that top lane pushed in. They really want it like a full split push going right now. Don't put all eggs in one basket. If they can get themselves a kill, then go for it. That's great. But they're keeping a split. We've only got 20 seconds really left over on that Aegis the Immortal. So Kunkka's kind of got to make the most out of this as opposed to just basic regeneration. I think now they realize, yeah, they're being watched on the high ground. And this is why they're not just finding an opening and Middle East was able to respond to them so well.
Yeah, the Tinker kind of reveals that one with his rockets flying everywhere.
Okay,
there goes the Aegis.
Kunkka's just regeneration now. That's all he is. So no Aegis the Immortal. There was no way he'd die in time. Fishing arrow, not going to find anything, even though the Lich is moving into position. And so is the Tinker. So this is jump time. Watching Mango on the sideline. The March Machine's already coming in, but it's a little bit deep. They are trying to go on this Mirana for the moment. She leaves herself away. That Impetus damage still onto the Wraith King, but he's also got Reincarnation. But the Mana Serpent Wards are now gone. So Terraform will slowly take away these abilities from Middle East.
That's why Parrish just goes back to bottom. Split pushes some more.
Yeah.
They've got all the time in the world to wait for Middle East to screw up somehow and give Tidehunter an opening.
What's the courier picking up at this point? It's over the secret shop at the moment. I'll keep it over in my selection. Because there's going to be a large amount of money.
I would hazard a guess that it is Paris. And he's going to use his 3k gold.
I would say it's Geralt picking up something big because he's got 5.4k gold.
Oh, wow.
Him.
He does. Yeah. But in which case, I would guess it would be the Mjolnir. Because static charge is always good when you have a nice frontline melee hero like Kunkka is. So I would have guessed it would have been the Mjolnir. So it means I'm right. It's going to be a Reaver.
Coming down to Sashka. Life points for now.
Come on,
Geralt also just had a really nice... it was just good timing for him. He triggered the Mana Star and was able to dodge both the Hellfire Blast as well as the rockets from Tinker. Radiant's really difficult to lock down into Mirana at this point. And Lich coming in that close. You gotta be careful. One quick enchant. We're still waiting for this blind Ravage from Mango, but he just uses Blink Dagger to go down. So not in, but the towers are within deny range. There's not much point denying it though, because they still want to be able to have that reveal over the mid. So yeah, they just frost armor it up and try and protect it with March of the Machines. Having the reveal to see where the Kunkka's moving is more important. But then again, Kunkka is just sitting on bottom lane.
Tinker, what a cancerous hero.
Really feel like this is
just
a
map. Like, how do you push into this? It's so obnoxious early on.
Hellfire Blast over on the Enchantress. Okay, committal as well from the ultimate. Coming out from the Viper, but there it is. Blink, Ravage, connects on three. Refresher has already gone off there, but not enough mana. He's actually short. Now the six charges will go. He's got enough mana, but they've already got the kills. Hey!
No.
That's overkill.
Celebratory Ravage.
Hey! Sashka, he's in trouble. Actually, no, he's not. He just cuts his way back out of the Madness Open Wards. Okay, this game is GG. 42-8. It was kind of GG beforehand. It was just when was the finishing blow going to come in. And that is it. That's going to be finishing blow coming
up. Celebratory Ravage is a real thing, man. I mean, look how happy Tidehunter is.
Just throwing your head up in the air. He's yelling.
Happy Tidehunter is happy.
Wonderful. Wonderful. All right, so Terra Firma get their win. They'll battle up against Ionix, or either that or Riot. They are the next two teams to battle up against each other. The round of 16 will be our final round of the day. So we have one more game coming your way, one more best of one, and then the competition will be ramped up over the course of tomorrow. Four teams have to come out from the Middle Eastern Open qualifier, and then they get into the main event. So, yeah, stay tuned for all of the action coming your way. In just a couple of moments' time, we'll be back with Terra's next game.